I'll be reading from the ESV. So here's James 1. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion. Greetings. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation, because like a flower of the grass, he will pass away. For the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass, its flower falls and its beauty perishes, so also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creature. This is the word of the Lord.
So, yeah, we preach through the entire book of Revelation, we preach through the entire book of Acts, and now we're going to start the entire book of James. And I like the book of James. It's short, sweet. He's interesting in that he was, tradition tells us, the brother, the half-brother of Jesus. And so he had an interesting upbringing, you know, being around God growing up would be pretty significant, I would imagine. He was also, he didn't believe Jesus was the Messiah at first. That's documented in Scripture. And actually, Jesus had to specifically go to him after the resurrection and basically say, hey, look, I am real. And at some point, that clicked, and he became known as James the Just or James the Camel-kneed. Apparently, he prayed so often that his knees had great thick calluses on there, like a camel, because of his prayer life. He's the brother of Jude. That's Jesus' other half-brother who wrote the book of Jude. And he's the one who is the senior pastor, it seems like, or the lead pastor in the church in Jerusalem. And so his focus was largely to the Jewish Christians, where Paul's focus was to the Gentile Christians. In verse 1, as James read, when you read this kickoff, he calls himself, I mean, if you ever wanted to name drop, being, again, the brother of Jesus would be a pretty good thing to kind of name drop. He doesn't. It's interesting. He doesn't say, I'm the brother of Jesus. He doesn't mention it at all, actually. He says, I'm the bondservant. The word is doulos. That's a slave by choice. It's somebody who became so close to the family that they chose to stay with the family, almost like, I'm dating myself. There was like a show called Mr. Belvedere back in the 80s, and he was like the lovable servant of this wealthy family, and he you know, it was almost like familial. A bondservant almost took on that role, where it was like a servant that was so close to the family that he chose to kind of almost covenantally bond himself to them and them to him. And so he's saying, I'm that, I'm a slave by choice to the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, he doesn't call him to my bro Jesus, to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he starts off, before he gets into this, you know, what I want to spend time discussing, the craziness of his statement of counting it joy when you go through various trials, which nobody does that I know of. Yet it's an exhortation we see over and over in Scripture. Before he gets to that, he points out who his audience is. He says, to the 12 tribes scattered throughout all the world. And so it sets the tone for his whole book, which is this idea of faith and action
in a world of opposition, and he points out that the church has been scattered everywhere. Much like the Levites. The Levites were the one tribe in Israel that didn't get their own property. They were sprinkled everywhere so that they could minister everywhere. And that's a picture of what the church is. You know, we're sent out and scattered everywhere around the world. We're not supposed to gather. We're not supposed to congregate. The church gets weird when it cloisters, when there's this hard separation between sacred and secular and a bunch of Christians just get together. It generally gets weird and culty. It's supposed to be scattered and spread, and that's exactly who James is addressing, so it's very apropos to who we are. And so here's the crazy part. Look at what he says. I'll read it again. My brothers, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Do you do that? It's a command. The Bible says so. You're supposed to. Do you count it all joy when you fall into various trials? The answer is probably no. Usually we count it all joy when we're winning, when things are going right. I count it all joy when I've gotten a promotion. I count it all joy when, you know, you've had a child and the child's healthy. You count it all joy when you're in a relationship and it's going really great. We count it all joy when things are good. We don't count it all joy when things are bad. And yet the command, it says, and not just here, I'll show you everywhere in Scripture where this is commanded. It says, count it all joy when you go through trials. And this is one reason people didn't know what to do with the early church, because that's not normal. That's not a normal command. That's not a normal response to trial. And for example, and I've referenced this before, when they would feed Christians in the arenas to wild animals, what's the appropriate response when a lion that's been starved is charging your way? Usually hysteria, run for your life, freak out and scream. Christians, history tells us, would lock arms and sing hymns while these wild animals would run at them and kill them. And the audience in Rome did not know what to do with that. That wasn't the response they were expecting. And a lot of the times they joined the church because they'd never seen resilience and they'd never seen joy in trial like that. And so how do we get some of that mojo? It's commanded, but it seems really hard. So we want to look at today, why and how? Do you even see this in real time? Do you even want this in real time? And how can we apply that spiritually? Because I think I can show you, you actually see this physically quite often. So this guy's name is Rich Froning. I'm not into CrossFit. I mean, I do some CrossFit type exercises, but I'm not a big CrossFitter. But he was the CrossFit champion for like, I think, 5 or 6 years in a row. And his famous saying is hashtag that sucked. And he always says it after one of his workouts. And it's really funny. I'm part of this personal training group here on Wednesdays. And this guy, he owns the gym. Anytime he says, this is going to suck today, you know you're in for it. Like I actually stopped, I was looking at my watch this last Wednesday. It stayed at right around 140 and 150 the whole time. There's no very little breaks. And there's something about kind of like it sucking in a group that makes it more palatable. And then even with F3 here, all the workouts are affectionately called beatdowns. That's what everyone calls it. They don't say, hey, let's work out. They say, hey, where's the beatdown this week? And so somehow, at least in the fitness world that I'm a part of, affliction becomes this weird thing you kind of like. And you know that somehow if you can get through the challenging workouts, whether it's alone or in a group, you feel better. It makes you stronger. It refines who you are as a human, not just physically, but often mentally. If I meet anybody, perhaps it's somebody who's super educated, I recognize there was a lot of hardship that they went through to achieve that master's degree or doctorate or whatever. If I meet anybody who's physically fit, I recognize that this person's probably disciplined and there's something they're doing. There's some type of hardship they've exposed themselves to that have produced the result that I'm seeing in their physical stature or whatnot. And so why should we? I just showed you how it is possible in the fitness world, and I think it follows suit in the church world. But the first thing we see is consider. James is like, hey, brothers, consider. And that's hegeomai, which means to lead, to command, to deem, to consider, to account, to esteem, to govern over. It means really, really think about this. Meditate on this. Consider this concept. What's the concept? Because this is the why should you, that trials, which are inevitable, which are coming your way. Jesus promised it. Every author in Scripture pretty much promised it. Trials produce steadfastness. Steadfastness perfects and completes your faith. It doesn't produce faith. It fine-tunes and completes your faith. So steadfastness, hupomone in Greek, means endurance, constancy, patient continuance, produces a more perfect faith, teleios, completeness, full age, mature is another word, and completeness, holokleros, complete in every part, whole. And so God will put you through trials on purpose, and the reason you can be joyful in them, or at least consider being joyful in them, is because you know they're intentional, because they produce more steadfastness, which leads to a more perfect and more complete faith. All right, so that's the why. But there's more. Why else? Because the Bible says so. Matthew 5, 10 through 12. I just want to show you how this isn't just like, wow, well, James was Jesus' brother. He's just really extreme or hardcore because he was like related to God and stuff. No, this is what everybody thought in Scripture. Matthew 5, 10 through 12. This is Jesus talking. He said, blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil things against you because of me. Not because you're lame or annoying, but because of Jesus. That's a pretty big disclaimer that you've got to understand in context. If it's for my name, because of your connection for me, you're blessed, because great is your reward in heaven. And rejoice and be glad. That's the command. Rejoice in persecution. Rejoice in false accusation, because great is your reward in heaven. For the same way they did this to you, the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. This has always happened with my followers, Jesus was saying. Romans 5 through 4. Now, this is Paul writing. He said, not only so, but we glory in our sufferings. This is the same thing James said. We glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character produces hope. All right, so this is a different author of the Bible who says the same thing. Why? Because the Holy Spirit is directing both to say the same thing. Because this is a reoccurring theme in life that we're all going to have to deal with. Hebrews 10, we don't know who the author is. Hebrews 10, 34. You suffered along with those in prison and joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property. How crazy is that? Because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. I went to this prayer for the persecuted church a couple years ago, and they had actual letters from people in the church in China that were that were pastors' wives. Their husbands were in prison. And I'll never forget one of them. She said, please have the church not pray for my husband's release unless that's God's will. And don't have the church pray for our possessions to be returned to us, because she had to leave her house and leave everything. Just pray that God teaches us what he wants to through this process. My husband in prison and me without a home. And I'm like, wow. It was said almost like, oh, that sounds like, that's just made up. You know, that just sounds like you're just, you know, you're really laying it on thick. It was just totally sincere. Just pray that God teaches us through this and that we'd have joy through this, not that we're vindicated from it, which is crazy. Such a sincere, heartfelt prayer. But it kind of echoes this sentiment where the church was losing everything at this time and they rejoiced in it. They didn't care because they knew that they had so much more in heaven. Like, how do you get to that? That's not normal. That's not a natural reaction to someone stealing your stuff. Usually it's anger, fight the power, revenge. Philippians 2:17, this is Paul writing, but even if I am being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith. Paul's saying, literally, if I am martyred for your faith, I'm glad and rejoice with all of you. He's like, I'm happy to die if it means, church in Philippi, that your faith increases. He says it to the church in Colossae also. Now I rejoice in why I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is lacking in regard to Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body, which is the church. He's like, I'm happy that I'm suffering if it means the church is growing through this process. I don't mind at all. Don't feel sorry for me. 2 Corinthians 8:1. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. So the church in Macedonia was so persecuted. In the midst of their persecution, they had joy, joy so much they still gave sacrificially out of their poverty. So, I don't know about you, but these verses, they sound kind of crazy. That's not a normal way of thinking. And yet it's a biblical way of thinking, and it's an exhortation that God told James and Paul, and Jesus himself exhorted the church to embody. So, how do we do this? And I think the text gives us answers to that question. Look at verse 3. This is, my brother, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. The first thing about faith, you've got to know, is it's something that you walk in. And again, it's something that's perfected through trial. It's not produced. When you become a Christian, you receive a certain amount of faith. It is just dispensed to you. How do you know that? Well, the Bible says the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, faithfulness. So it's given to you. But it's something that you've got to feed and you've got to fan to get it to grow bigger. Part of that, God, he helps you out. Remember when Jesus talked about God being a vine dresser? God the Father, do you remember that teaching? So you think about, you've got the Holy Spirit, if you're a Christian, who's in you, yielding fruit. But then you've got God, who's a vine, he's a pruner. And so he's intentionally pruning back your life, a.k.a. allowing trials to come in to make you more fruitful, and one of those fruits is increased faith. Does that make sense? So you've got this kind of twofold thing going on, the Holy Spirit in you and God the Father outside of you, messing with your life lovingly to get you to be more fruitful and more faithful. This is what I quote Spurgeon a lot today, but he says, faith, he was an English preacher many years ago, faith is as vital to salvation as the heart is vital to the body. Hence, the javelins of the enemy are mainly aimed at this essential grace. Another pastor by the name of Clark said, the man of two souls, who has one for the earth and another for heaven, who wishes to secure both worlds, he will not give up the earth, and he is loath to let go of heaven. Because in the text, it says that we can't be double-minded in our faith. You've got this pull, right? One is to walk in the flesh, the other is to walk in the spirit. Sam and I were talking about this the other day. Whatever you feed the most is the one you walk in. So you want to walk in faith, you've got to do things like, the Bible says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So the more time you spend in the word of God, the more your faith grows. But you've got to embrace trials because it's the trials that are perfecting your faith. So I think sometimes, and how do you count it all joy? You recognize that the trial is intentional and purposeful, just like going to the gym when you don't want to, just like taking a run when you don't want to, just like studying when you don't want to. It's intentional because it's yielding an end result. So sometimes enduring the trial or the challenge is easier when you recognize it's purposeful and it's leading to something bigger. Make sense? So faith is one important dynamic that you've got to make sure you understand. God is going to do things to proactively grow your faith. Second thing in verse 5, it says to ask for wisdom. Ask for wisdom in the midst of the trial. And sometimes I don't think we do that. I know sometimes that's not my first thought. I just kind of want relief from the trial. Sometimes I pray for more grace to get through the trial, but often I don't ask for wisdom as to, okay, well, what's the purpose of this maybe? Am I missing something? Is this teaching me something? Is this trying to get me to stop doing something? Is this trying to open my eyes to something I'm missing, maybe ministerially speaking? Spurgeon again says, we are also ready to go to books, to go to men, to go to ceremonies, to go to anything except God. Consequently, the text does not say, let him ask books, nor ask priests, but let him ask of God. So how do you get through trials? How do you consider trials to be joyful, sometimes to say, God, give me wisdom as to why this is happening. I'm not saying you'll always get it. Sometimes you'll get more clarity for it. Sometimes you will get more grace for it. Sometimes it makes sense when you're older. Sometimes it just won't make sense to sight of heaven. But nonetheless, we're called to ask for wisdom. So first, recognize that the trial is growing your faith. Secondly, recognize that you've got almost like one of those game shows where you can kind of push the button and get like a call for help or whatever. What was that game where you got like a lifeline where you could call someone to answer it? That's pretty much, what is it? Yes, there you go. Cash cab, yeah. So you've got that line to God where, God, give me wisdom in what's happening in this situation. Next is perspective, which is interesting. Look at verse 9. It says, let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation. Now that's ironic. That's not how it works. Let the lowly brother, usually if you're lowly, you're kind of down on yourself, you feel stupid, you feel, you know, lame, worthless. I was talking to a friend the other day. I was like, how's your walk going right now? How are things going in your life? He's like, yeah, you know that part in Star Wars where Anakin's legs are chopped off and his arms chopped off and he's on fire and he's crawling? Kind of like that. I'm like, awesome, that good. Now quit beating around the bush. I need more clarity as to what's going on in your life. And it was so funny because it was so sincere and authentic as to just how it was going. And that was how it was going. But what's interesting is the perspective in the Bible is when you're like that, look at what it says in verse 9. I love the Bible. It's such a book of opposites. Let the lowly brother who's on fire with no arms and one, you know, no legs and one arm crawling, rejoice or glory in his exaltation. But the rich in his humiliation. Again, that seems like it's flipped. Usually if you're rich, that's a good thing, right? That's winning. You've won the game. You're blessed. Because as a flower of the field, he will pass away. For no sooner has the sun risen with a burning heat than it withers the grass. Its flower falls, and its beautiful appearance perishes. So the rich man also will fade away in his pursuits. So trials serve to remind the rich and the high, that though they are comfortable in this life, it is still only for this life, which fades as the grass grows brown and the flowers fade away. Whenever the Bible describes life, it's as a drop in the bucket or as the width of your hand. Short, quick. Naked a man enters the world, naked he departs. So if you're basing everything, your value, your identity, your joy, on your riches, it's a dead-end road because eventually you're going to die and you could lose your riches this side of heaven also. And so as the poor brother forgets all his earthly poverty, so the rich brother forgets all his earthly riches. So by faith in Christ, the two men are equals. And so I think your perspective is so important when you're going through trials. It's like the gospel is the great equalizer, whether you're rich or whether you're poor. Because you get the same thing in Christ. God doesn't love you more because you're rich or less because you're rich or more because you're poor or anything like that. So there's this equality that all has to do with your perspective. So if the trial makes you feel lowly, rejoice in it because God's doing something through it. And if the blessing makes you feel higher than you should about yourself, then recognize you could lose it tomorrow and it fades quickly, and that should keep you humble. But your perspective, whether you're a have or a have not, is affected by the trial. Does that make sense? So trials are easier to consider when you have the right perspective about things. And then love in verse 12. Look at this. It says, blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. And so now we're, you know, James is folding in an eternal perspective, an eternal reward, not just the temporal one. What's the temporal reward for suffering? It's going to make me more mature in my faith. It's going to make me a stronger Christian. As we saw last week, it's going to broaden my ministry because pain is that connecting point to the world. And often God takes my pain and the fact that I've gotten through it, and he uses that in the lives of people. That's all temporal stuff. Good, but temporal. Now James is folding in this idea of reward, this crown that you receive. It could be literal, it could be figurative, but there is a reward for people who have loved God through trials that you receive one day in heaven. We looked at this reward concept in Revelation over and over again, where you are rewarded for what you do on earth forever. Now, there's no, like, usually, like, when people trip out in heaven, like, well, that sounds weird. Like, aren't, because my dad would always use this really, I hate when people be like, oh, you know, as long as I'm just sweeping the streets in heaven, or as long as I'm your janitor son. And I'm like, Dad, that is so, like, not inspiring. You know, let's raise the bar a little higher. Let's not try to just be, you know, but there's this concept, like, well, aren't you jealous in heaven then if someone has more? How does it even work out? Well, look, if it's heaven and there's no such thing as jealousy, then you're just going to be super stoked for each other. And if someone has more, whether that's a greater capacity to experience heaven, I don't know how it's going to go down. But all I know is there are rewards for how you live your life on earth. And one of those is loving God through trial. And so love is something we want to maintain through our trials. Spurgeon again. So that those who endure temptation rightly endure it because they love God. They say to themselves, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? They cannot fall into the sin because it would grieve him who loves them so well and whom they love with their hearts. So the temptation will be to curse God and die. Remember, that was what Job's wife said to do in the midst of his trial. She said, I curse God and die. And he's like, no, though he slay me, I will trust him. Job had this sincere love for God. And I guarantee you, he's going to get the crown of life that was referenced. So how do you count it all joy through various trials? Recognize there's a temporal purpose, but there's also an eternal reward. And all you have to do is continue to love and trust God through the trial, which I know is not easy always. But at least scripturally, we're warned about it, and it's spoken of. Because it's connection to the temptation that we're supposed to avoid in verse 13. And that's just to think that God is the one tempting us when that's impossible for God to do. And we're drawn away in that temptation. So it's a metaphor that alludes to bait that distracts you and pulls you away from where you're supposed to be and gets you hooked and eventually killed. And so we're to avoid that temptation that was with us since the beginning of time, of thinking that God doesn't really love you and doesn't really have your best intentions in mind. And he's messing with you because he's mad at you. James is trying to break that thought. That's not true. Suffering is intentional. God uses it. He loves you. You can love him through it. So avoid the temptation to doubt God or to think that God somehow has forgotten you, because he hasn't. So you've got to recognize that will be a quick temptation in the midst of any trial. Why, God, why? Why are you doing this to me? And James is saying, don't think like that. God's got a purpose for everything, even our trial. So don't be drawn away into hating him because of the trial. Love him because it's intentional and purposeful, and it's refining your faith. And then finally, or next to finally, purpose, know it. It says that we're called God's first fruits in verse 18. It says, of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Proverbs 3:9, it says, honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your crops. First fruits were the first crop that popped up, you were to bring to the priest and offer as a gift, saying, it's not just my tithe, it's not just my 10%. This is the first and the best stuff I've got, and I want to give it to God straight away, as soon as the harvest began. So God is saying, James is saying to us through God in verse 18, that we're a first fruit. Who? The people of God, the church. We're a first fruit for the planet. So you always hear me talking about, it's a popular gospel sentence, joining God in the restoration of all things, how we're taking everything and we're trying to redeem it, how we work. how we live, how we speak, how we love, how everything we do, we're joining God in the restoration of all things until he comes back to restore it all once and for all. Does that make sense? So in that process, we are considered first fruits to the planet, to the people, to everything, the created order. The people of God, Christians, we are a gift to the earth in a sense that we're supposed to be. We don't act like it often, but we're supposed to be this gift to mankind, this reflection of God to people, a tangible, a Christian is a little Jesus, a tangible, touchable, hearable version of Jesus that people can see, that's supposed to point them to Jesus. How we handle trials is part of that. So if you want to be the very best first fruit possible, because that's who we are, then you better believe God's going to do things to refine you, to beautify you, to polish you, to make you the most effective first fruit possible on your block, in your apartment complex, in your city, in the world. And so, of course, if trials are going to be the refining force in your life to bring you to that place of being an ideal first fruit, God's going to let it happen. Now, last point. How do you, gospel, fix your eyes on it? Hebrews 12, 1 through 3. I love how Jesus embodies every command James gave us, Jesus embodied perfectly. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him, second command, consider him. First, fix your eyes on. Second, consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So how do you consider it to be joyful when you go through trials? By considering the one who had you on his mind when he went through his own trial to save you and me from our sins. That's the gospel, that Jesus embraced trial. He embraced the cross because he knew it would save us from our sins. We were the joy set before him. We were the ones on his mind when he endured the cross. And we are to fix our eyes on that fact and to consider that fact, recognizing that if he loved us that much, then of course this trial is intentional. Of course he's using it. It's not just that he said he would, because that's part of it. It's that he loves me and he's not going to do anything to mess with me on purpose. It's got to be intentional. It's making me a better first fruit for the planet, for the people around me. So when you understand the gospel, all those other things fall in line, and the trial that you're enduring becomes all the more endurable. And so, application. When you experience any sort of trial, which of the six areas from the text do you find the most challenging? Faith. Do you believe that God has control of everything? That's called sovereignty. Sovereignty revolutionized my walk with God. Because I used to be stuck in this, oh, is this the perfect will of God? Is this the permissive will of God? Did I miss the perfect will of God? Oh my gosh, what am I in? When I recognize, no, it's just all God's will. The good, the bad, the ugly, all of it. I can't mess it up. He's sovereign over everything. All things work together for the good of those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. So faith, do you believe that God is in control of everything, even the trial that he's allowing in your life right now? Wisdom, do you ask to see how this trial might be working in your life and in the lives of others? Or are your prayers just, get me out of this, God? Why are you doing this to me, God? Is it, God, give me wisdom so I understand how to navigate this challenging season? Perspective, does it tend to be heavenly or earthly when you're looking at the trial in front of you? Love, do you find it hard to love God in the midst of trials? Because that's going to be a constant temptation, is to doubt the goodness of God when he allows stuff to happen to your life that's hard. Purpose, do you see yourself as a first fruit that not just sometimes, that always needs pruning for the rest of your life. To really flourish, you've got to be cut back. And God is proactive in that, and it hurts. But you've got to know that there's a purpose behind it. And then finally, gospel. Is the gospel something you fix your eyes on regularly? Which is why I always say church is so important. Because it's a reminder through song, through prayer, through creed, through sermon. It's a reminder of the gospel from start to finish. Same with the midweek service. Same with your devotional life. Same with your prayer life. All those things are meant to be reminders of the gospel. Which is why our mission statement is helping all people see the beauty of Jesus more clearly so they can live on mission more fully. You've got to see the beauty of Jesus in the gospel. Or else you're not going to do anything. You'll have zero motivation to live on mission.